Alrighty, so today we're looking at chapter 6 of the behavior change special. This is going to be talking about what we will refer to as CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy. This is different than behavior therapy, but it does somewhat feel similar in that, like, yesterday we had sort of looked at habit loops, right? You know, like a habit loop is where you'll experience, you know, some type of cue or trigger or antecedent, if we're being all scientific about it. You'll kind of experience that, and then that causes you to go through some type of routine, and then that routine sort of causes you to have some type of like consequence of some type, right? One of my favorite ways to analyze that is to look at it from like the ABCs, which I do like the term just because I just like that, you know, set up. But it's like the, you have an antecedent, then you have a behavior, and then you have a consequence, right? A, B, and then C. But you have a cue, routine, reward, whenever we're talking about behavior therapy. Well, cognitive behavioral therapy is looking at the same thing, but it's more like you have a cue, and then that causes some type of like emotional or psychological feeling, and then there's a consequence or fallout from that, right? And that can be a really positive thing. Like if there's, you know, something that kind of builds up your confidence, you know, that's great. I was just talking the other day about the show Ted Lasso. I don't know if either of you guys have watched Ted Lasso, but I freaking love that show. And if I could, I would if it wasn't the most unprofessional thing in the world to do, I would absolutely give out extra credit for watching Ted Lasso. And I'd be like, because I do believe that like it is a freaking master course on how to be like more positive and more optimistic. But there's a great line here. I got to show you this like funny line right here that I think of. When I think of cognitive behavioral therapy, there's this, I think this is a very, very funny line that I think applies to it very well, and I've been looking forward to like showing this clip for a couple days now. But here, listen to this weird little bit from the show. This is gonna get me copyright in trouble so quickly.
That's a long time to wait, Ted.
Well, I respect you didn't hurry.
So, how was your first official day?
I'm not entirely sure what y'all's smallest unit of measurement is over here, but that's about how much headway I made.
And yet you seem undeterred.
Solid entrance.
What would you rather be, a lion or a panda?
I don't have time for this.
A lion or a panda?
Ted?
Gotta go panda.
Are you mad? Pandas are fat and lazy and have piss-stained fur. Lions are powerful and majestic and rule the jungle.
Try telling that to an elephant.
Ooh, could I be an elephant?
Mm-mm, lion or panda?
Panda.
Lion! What's black and white and red all over?
I don't know what.
A panda that gets anywhere near a fucking lion. The answer is lion.
That Rebecca is an intimidating, very tall woman. I mean, the minute she locked eyes with me, I like started sweating.
Oh, no. You know, she got some pencil, all right, but you just gotta hop over her.
Hi, babe. Here. Keys.
Hey, Jamie, what would you rather be? A lion or a panda?
Coach, I'm me. Why would I want to be anything else?
I'm not sure you realize how psychologically healthy that actually is.
Cheers.
Night, Porter.
So that is one of my favorite lines in that entire freaking show. He's like, I'm me. Why would I want to be anything else? It's like, I'm not sure you realize how psychologically healthy that is. That honestly is exactly what cognitive behavioral therapy is all about. Like, it is all about recognizing how to be the psychologically sort of healthiest version of yourself. And, you know, analyzing that and creating like sort of, you know, having a positive impact on things. So I love that clip. I have been looking forward to showing that for days. So anyway, let's go ahead and break down CBT, as most people will sort of shorten it to and sort of affectionately refer to it as, but that's our cognitive behavioral therapy. So if behavior therapy focuses on your behaviors, while cognitive behavioral therapy takes those principles and focuses on people's thoughts, emotions, and behaviors, and how they sort of affect and lead to one another, right? So what this does is it leads to interventions that are much more focused around like understanding your own thinking patterns, understanding your own feelings. And then we focus on creating like new routines and new healthy versions of things so that you have better thoughts and better feelings on things. And you are, you know, sort of psychologically healthy. You're like, I'm me, Bob, I don't want to be anything else. So one of the big things we got to talk about before we actually even break into looking at the different like versions of how to apply CBT, one thing that we have to understand is we have to understand, have a pretty good understanding of what the idea of personality is. So when you think of like what someone's personality is, you're like, oh, that person has like a really outgoing personality, or oh, that person tends to be kind of shy, or oh, that person tends to be analytical, you know. Individuals are going to behave in various different ways in daily life. And there are so many personality tests out there, right, guys? I mean, like there's the Myers-Briggs, which is probably the most famous. If you guys have ever taken the Myers-Briggs test to sort of tell you what sort of personality you have, they break it down. Now Myers-Briggs has added like, you know, they've added like personality, like archetypes to go with it. It's like, oh, that's the warrior or something. But it's like all these kind of, oh my God, there's a Star Wars version of the Myers-Briggs. That's really funny. but like, basically they break things down into a couple different like categories here. You can see like, you know, sort of where you get your energy from, whether you're introverted or extroverted, how you process information, how you process like decision making, and then like whether or not you have a need for structure in your life, or if you're somebody who, you know, like doesn't need a plan, you know. So it's a little bit different. It's like these are the sort of different sort of versions out there. Are you a thinker or are you a feeler? Are you a judger or are you a perceiver? So it gives you a you know, sort of personality based on these eight sort of key aspects. And so like that can allow you to kind of break things down. And they're one of many personality tests that are out there. But one that NASM is sort of like putting a little emphasis on is the idea of what is called the Big Five personality test. And I've actually got a copy of this that I'm going to attach to you guys today so you can take a look at it. But the Big Five personality test is actually, gosh darn it, there and then there and then there and then here. I got too many folders on this computer. Actually, where the heck is my handout? What? Where is it? all right, well, I'll find that later. It's literally right here. So the Big Five personality is sort of a five key aspects, right? And so if we look at it, we are going to judge your ocean is what they're sort of calling it, right? So instead of breaking things down in like the Myers-Briggs way, we're breaking it down into these five key categories here. So it is the Big Five personality test is an assessment that's designed to divide common personalities into five very broad dimensions that will describe people's tendencies to behave in fairly predictable ways, right? So you would ask your client, or you would ask yourself, if you want to do it yourself, a series of questions to determine your openness to experiences. People who tend to be very open are people who tend to be very inventive and very curious, rather than people who tend to be very like cautious or very consistent. So, you know, if I were to ask Bay, you know, Bay, do you see yourself as like very inventive and curious? Like you like to try new things, or are you somebody who likes to be pretty consistent and cautious and likes to kind of stick to sort of the same routine? Like if you went to a restaurant, Bay, question for you, would you order something you've never had before, or would you order something that you know that you really, really like?
That's a funny question. Yeah, I like to stick to my usual food because since I'm, you know, if you're saying food, I would stick to my kind of food that I love and I really enjoy eating. But but as far as for other reasons like business or just any other thing, I like to be more spontaneous to challenge myself, to learn.
Love that, love it. Here's like all these are good, you know, like there's no right answer when it comes to all these. These are just sort of like ways of kind of looking at your general personality. So that's sort of what the O in the Ocean Big Five is, right? It's the I love, by the way, I forgot to make this joke, I love that we get to talk about Big Five in our you know personal fitness class. But in this case, it's a personality test, has nothing to do with athletics. But I love, like, your openness is your tendency for curiosity. Like some people are very, you know, they like to do new things all the time. Whereas some people like to be like consistent, like me. I think that like I tend to be kind of a blend here myself. I see that, you know, I do like to kind of change things up and I like to kind of shake it up every now and then. But at the same time, there are certain parts of my life that I just don't like to have to think about. I like to be on autopilot. So like in that closet back there, there are 6 white V-necks and there are 6 black V-necks. And that way, like it gets me through the week where and then I can dress nicely on Sundays and, you know, wear something else. But like, those are my sort of daily t-shirts. I say there's 6. They're actually, I need to order a new pack. They're worn out at this point. But but that's sort of the you know, the ways that I'm not very curious. I'm like, nope, I'm just consistent. I just want to get through, you know, get dressed and move on with my day. And then we got conscientiousness. This is the sea and ocean. The people who have a high level of conscientiousness tend to be people who are very organized and very efficient, rather than people who tend to be a little bit more easygoing, a little bit careless, right? You know, Thomas, you know, it's time to pick on you. do you tend to see yourself as very like organized? Are you very like efficient? Do you like, you know, like a nice organized desk, or do you tend to be like a little bit more easygoing?
More so organized.
Yeah. So yes. Do you, like, here's a question for you. Do you make your bed every day?
Yes.
Oh man. See, I only do it because of Zoom. Because I'm like, I have to be a professional. I am not a natural bed maker. All right. Love that. Yeah. So conscientiousness, by the way, is, and we will see this statistic, I believe this is actually a homework question, is actually one of our biggest predictors of weight status. We tend to find that people who have a hard time having conscientiousness are the same people who tend to have a hard time like managing their weight. So the people who have a higher level of conscientiousness are usually a little bit more structured about what they put into their body. They're a little bit more structured about carving time out to be physically active. And that's probably on the Big Five, the one that's sort of most relevant to us. So that's good, Thomas. It's going to keep you in good shape.
That's right.
Darn right. All right. What about extroversion? So the E in extroversion, this tends to be people who tend to be very extroverted are people who tend to be very outgoing and very energetic versus people who tend to be a little more solitary or people who tend to be a little bit more reserved, right? So an extrovert is somebody who, you know, they often get a lot of energy being in a crowd. They get a lot of energy by being around others, whereas somebody who's a little bit more solitary, they're a little bit more introverted, right? And like that person is gonna sort of do well in like a small group. They tend to have like, you know, less numerically in terms of friends, but they tend to have like very, very strong, you know, extremely strong bonds with like a small group of people. So that's sort of the extroversion side of things. The next one we've got is agreeable. Agreeableness are people who tend to be very like friendly and very compassionate versus people who tend to be a little bit more analytical and maybe detached. You know, you think about like I always ask people, it's like, could you see yourself being like a surgeon, you know? And some people would make great surgeons, you know? They're like, yeah, absolutely. I would like, you know. But for me, it's like, oh, I don't know. It kind of gives me the heebie-jeebies to think about, like, you know, chopping away at like another person. Like, I think I would have a hard time with that. And it's like, but you're, and like the other person would be like, yeah, but like, you know, you are helping that person. Like, you have to do this in order to like help them. That's a very analytical way of approaching it. And it's true. Like, you know, you're going to have a very positive impact on someone's life, but you kind of, it's like, you kind of have to do this, like, you know, destructive thing in order to help them. I think if you're able to be very analytical about that, then great. But for me, I'm too sort of attached to the action. And that's, you know, I don't think I'd make a very good, surgeon. So that's sort of the agreeable. I actually have this, when I play Ultimate. There's a guy that I play with who doesn't wear, we're all wearing cleats. And this guy's one of the best players we have. And he's always out there barefoot. And I don't guard him. I'm like, nope, if I ever step on his foot, I'm just going to absolutely like lose it, you know, like I'll feel bad for days. And the more sort of analytical side of that is like, he's the one who chose not to wear cleats. Like, yeah, you should just play. And I think that those people are right, but I don't have it in me. So that's the agreeableness side of things. Sort of the people pleaser versus the more, it's like, no, this is what's good for you, you know? And then we have neuroticism. People who tend to be neurotic are people who tend to be a little bit more sensitive, a little bit nervous sometimes, versus people who tend to be very confident and very secure, you know? I will say generally, we see, it's funny. I think everybody has like a certain level of neuroticism. You know, everybody has like aspects of all of these. There's no escape, you know, these are very, 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 very broad things. So they're gonna apply to pretty much everyone. But like, we all have like the things that we're sensitive about. We all have the things that we're sort of nervous about. But I will say, like, in the PFT program, it tends to be, we get a lot of very secure, very confident people, which is sort of what leads to, you know, being very good at like sort of group exercise, you know? But not everybody is going to be like a group exercise person. Some of you guys are like, nope, I want to work one-on-one with people, or I want to work in nutrition or something like that. And those are great, right? Those are great qualities to have. And there's, you know, a lot of opportunity there, but maybe you're the type of person who tends to be very extroverted and, you know, very low levels of neuroticism. You may find that like you do much better in a group setting where it's like, I want to work with as many people as possible. I want to get, you know, I want to have that energy and get everybody excited. It's like, great. You know, again, no good or bad. These are all just sort of key aspects that are all sort of fun. So that's neuroticism. So Big Five personality test is a really fun way to kind of help identify these things. It's very, very simple. I've you know, I honestly came to the Big Five personality test after I sort of stopped doing as much personal training. But I will say this, I like to ask questions, and I think of these sort of five key aspects when I'm getting to know somebody, whether that's like a personal relationship, or if it's like you know, personal friendship, or if it's like a professional relationship, like with a client or something. I've started like asking questions related to this, even if that doesn't mean, even if that doesn't involve actually giving out a personality test and like fill this out and then we can talk about what the means. You know, what we'll see is like people can receive high scores in more than one level, but you know, for the record, like people can definitely like score very high in here and here and here. It's not like you have one aspect of personality. But the big one that we are sort of paying attention to, and something that you probably want to ask a lot of questions in relation to, is the conscientiousness. Okay. So conscientiousness is it's a predictor of weight status. We tend to see that people who have like normal BMIs are people who have higher levels of conscientiousness. Think about conscientiousness as your awareness. Like, you know, Bay, Thomas, think of like your level of conscientiousness as how often like are, you know, do you think, if I asked you like to kind of go back through your day yesterday and think about like all the things that you ate, how easy would it be for you to remember the last 24 hours, you know? That's a little bit of the conscientiousness side of things. Like, how conscious of your life are you, you know? Me, I would find it very easy. I tend to have a pretty high level of conscientiousness myself. you know, and there's certain things that like I do totally forget, you know. There are certain ways that I'm definitely not very organized. But when it comes to like my you know, my eating habits and my exercise habits, those are two things that I have a lot of awareness of. I like using workout journals. I like to write things down. I like to have a very clear structure to what my workout and my diet are. And that's a very conscientious thing. And that's why that's sort of associated with obesity, right? So clients with low levels of conscientiousness, if you recognize that in your client, you ask your clients like, what'd you eat over the last 24 hours? And they're like, oh, I have no idea. It was something random, you know? If you have a client like that, that means that you could sort of, it's a sort of a warning flag that you are going to need to apply a little bit closer monitoring on that client. They made it a little bit more handholding, you know? And this is where like, okay, well, what can we do to sort of increase someone's conscientiousness? Well, one of our best tools would be like self-monitoring tools like journaling. So getting a client to journal can actually be a really helpful tool in order to increase someone's conscientiousness. So do either of you guys use workout journals? Thomas, do you track your weights?
I used to. I don't do it more so now, but I used to when I was more so serious.
Yeah, that's the thing too. Like if it's a little bit more casual, you know, yeah, maybe not as much. Or if you've got a great memory, you know, then yeah, maybe you're going to be fine. Me, I love, you know, I'm moving the weight around constantly, like, especially right now where I'm doing, you know, like powerlifting. It's like, I'm, you know, I'm like, can I do an extra 5 pounds here? You know, and I'll write it down and try to do 5 pounds. And it's like, oh, I didn't get all reps. You know, I was one rep short. I like to write that down so that the next time I see my workout, I'm like, oh, okay. So I was able to lift a little heavier, but I didn't make that last repetition. So then like that allows me to kind of dial things in a little bit more specifically. That's very much what we're looking at when we talk about like conscientiousness. And so journaling, food journaling, self-monitoring, things like that. I told you guys this story last month, but I'm going to bring it up again. There's a really famous thing about how they put people on food journals. They were like, hey, we're going to put you on this diet and we want to see what it does to your weight and stuff. Don't change your diet, but we want you to food journal for the next 2 weeks. And they noticed that everybody who started food journaling lost weight. And it was not because like, you know, they changed their diets. Although I'm sure some people were like, oh, I'm going to go on this diet. So then they started maybe early or something. But people just started writing all their food down. And that awareness brought them to like make specific food changes. It increased their conscientiousness. So that's probably the biggest one that we're going to sort of pay attention to, just because it determines whether or not our client is going to need closer monitoring. But I will find this darn thing and attach this to you guys. You can take this little personality quiz if you'd like. There's a little description in the beginning. I wrote this actually, because I took this right out of your textbook. But there is the sort of CBT side of things. And then what you're going to do is you're going to rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 7, how much you either agree or disagree that you are, you know, sort of like what is being described. And so like, you know, you see yourself as open to new experiences. If you see yourself as a 1, you would put a 1. Or if you're like, oh yeah, no, I strongly agree, you'd give yourself a 7. And then like the next one is, do you see yourself as very unconventional and creative? Or again, like, do you like more of a routine? You know, that's, you're going to say, yeah, unconventional and creative, that's a 7. Or it's like, no, I like routine. It's like, okay, you strongly disagree with that. And so then what you do is you actually mark the first two questions here in the openness, the second two questions in conscientiousness, the third two questions on extroverted, fourth two, fifth two. So you're going to go through all these 10 questions here, and then you're going to rank yourself. Like if you set a 7 in both of these first two, you would mark a dot right here. And then what that does is that creates what's called a spider chart. And spider charts are really cool. Really cool graphs that allow you to sort of look at these different aspects of things. And, you know, they kind of go in a specific order, and it's like, okay, most of our, you know, whatever this is, we're mostly concentrated over here on this side of things. Whereas this person in orange is a little bit more concentrated, you know, here and here. So it's kind of a fun type of chart, kind of a fun type of graph that allows you to sort of look at your personality and sort of see what your brain sort of maps out. So I'll attach that today. This is also in your reading. If you want to take a look at it just in your textbook, you can. It's in that chapter 6. But yeah, so I'll attach that for you guys today. Okay, so now that we know a little bit about personality, and we know a little bit about how cognitive behavioral therapy is focusing on thoughts and how your personality is sort of interacting with the world, right? We're going to talk about some of the different techniques that we can use that are related to CBT in sort of a normal personal training setting. Because obviously, like, again, we're getting pretty deep into, you know, the sort of actual therapy territory, which we are not therapists, we are not psychiatrists, or we're not applying, you know, therapy. We're just sort of taking some of these general principles and sort of co-opting them, you know, co-opting. we're kind of just stealing some of these, right? So goal setting is an example of this, planning, decisional counseling, that's a big one, where it's like, you know, what are the 80% of decisions that, or what are the 20% of things that give you 80% of the best results? Visualization, which we'll talk more about tomorrow, problem solving, stress management, and then there's some other ones out there as well. So one of the biggest things that you can do, which I think is really fun, is you can create healthy obsessions, you know? And a lot of times we hear the word obsessed, and we're like, oh, that person's obsessed. So it's like, that tends to be kind of a bad thing, you know? But healthy obsessions are good things. They're healthy, you know? And what a healthy obsession is it is a constant sort of preoccupation with the planning and execution of our targeted behaviors or whatever it is we are trying to actually achieve. So for instance, again, I know I talk about this a lot, but you know, I use you guys to keep me motivated, which is why I bring it up so often, because the biggest life goal that I have right now, I mean, don't get me wrong, like I've got some strength goals, you know, I'm trying to like get my deadlift up. I got this like freaking, you know, 700 pounds worth of plates the other day. And it's like, I want to use all of them, right? Like, one of my goals is to be able to deadlift 2.5 pounds my body weight. So that's like a fitness goal that I have. So like, you know, trying to get to at least a 437 pound deadlift. it's so funny. If Mo heard that, he'd be like, psh, I can do that. I can rip that up. Mo's a deadlifting master, but that is like one of my, well, that's like one of my strength goals that I have. And so like, if I constantly like sort of preoccupy with that, and I do sort of, I actually have it written down every time I get a new workout journal, cause I'm, you know, going through them all the time. I always put like that strength goal and all my other ones in there. Actually, I put it in the front page, and that way, like, you know, whenever I open the book, I can take a second to see that. That's a healthy obsession. It's an obsession with something that makes me healthier, right? I think another one is like, I'm trying to have like a healthy obsession with my finances. I check my spending every day to see how it is compared to last month. You know, I'm constantly checking my savings accounts and seeing how, you know, whether or not like that's growing or if they're depleting and what changes I can make, what positive things, you know, that's an obsession with a healthy habit, right? So it's a constant preoccupation with targeted behaviors. Targeted behaviors are the things you want to do, right? You know, Thomas, you make your bed every day, you said, right? That's a healthy habit to have. That's a really good, you know, positive thing. So if you, you know, constantly are sharing that with people where you're like, oh yeah, no, I make my bed every day. You are sort of obsessing on it. And you're like, I'm obsessed with this thing that makes me healthy. If you're obsessed with like talking about like, oh, I love going to the gym, let me tell you about this workout routine I'm on, right? You sort of have this preoccupation with this very, very cool thing. Let me tell you about like this really good diet that I'm on. Let me tell you about my favorite food, you know? And you get really passionate. You see somebody's face light up, right? That's somebody who has sort of a healthy obsession with something. So a lot of times we think about like a long-term goal, you know, it's achieved by having a healthy obsession with, you know, some, sort of task or something that someone is trying to achieve in like the very much the long-term. And this is where, again, one of our best techniques is the idea of like self-monitoring, right? So, if we are sort of like reviewing this like systematic observation, right? How often do you have these targeted behaviors? So like for me, I downloaded this really great app lately. It's a habit tracker app. It asks me, you know, one of the things I'm trying to get better at is like sleeping, you know, I'm trying to like get my freaking 8 hours. I always like, I'm like, I'll take 7 hours. And I'm pretty good about getting 7 hours. But it's like, you know, seven is like such the, just the, I'm talking about sleep. Now I'm yawning. You know, sleep is such an important thing. And like seven is the bare minimum. And when you aim for seven, you end up landing on like, you know, 6:45 or something. And so like, I'm pretty good about like getting into bed around like right around the 7 hour mark, but then like, I don't get to sleep probably for another half hour or something. And that's not great, right? So what I need to do is switch that to aiming for eight to 9 hours. And that way, if I aim for nine, maybe I'll land on eight, you know? And that's, so this habit tracker, you know, basically like texts me and it goes, bling, are you going to bed right now? And that's, you know, how I phrased it. You can set up any habit you want. You can, and it's just like a little thing. And like, what you can do is you can hit the check mark, yes or no. And then that allows you to kind of track things, and it shows it sort of laid out in sort of a chart form. So I'll show you what this sort of looks like. That's not how you spell habit. So you can see here, my bedtime one is not super awesome. And you can kind of see the, yeah, there you go. You can kind of see like it's a graph, and it's pretty freaking flat because I have not been doing a great job over the last week. Ideally, it would sort of be on an upswing, but mine is, you know, it was like, you did very good here, and then back to bad habits. So that's kind of a habit tracker, right? So it's a way to help me sort of self-monitor on things. Some people can be calories, some people can be exercise, you know. I would put exercise in there if I wasn't for the fact that like, I know I'm very good at not missing a workout. I haven't missed a workout in, you know, a couple months. But like, you know, that's, it's kind of a fun thing. So self-monitoring, journaling, using an app, you know, lots of different versions out there. Systematic, you know, putting a system in place that allows you to observe your target behaviors and then record whether or not you are achieving those target behaviors, right? So I got a little video to show you. This is actually a NASM video. This one's actually not online, so I got to go to my little thing here. Video presentations on day five. Here's a little bit of self-monitoring. So this is going to be sort of a little role play here. I'll be honest, you know, these are, remember that the person in this video is a personal trainer, not a trained actor. Good Lord, my phone is blowing up. Shut up, whoever that is. but remember, they are not necessarily an actor. This is this is a trainer. So, you know, a little slack here. okay, here we go.
As a fitness or wellness professional, it should be the goal to help the client to get to a point where they can sustain long-term behavior change. One of the key components in making this happen is the development of self-monitoring by the client. Self-monitoring is the systematic observation and recording of target behaviors. Self-monitoring provides feedback for the client while also teaching them the awareness they need in order to maintain the healthy behavior changes they have made. There are many techniques that can be utilized for self-monitoring. For example, phone and tablet apps are a quick and easily accessible way for clients to begin self-monitoring. This may be as simple as tracking nutrition and exercise in the notes section of a phone to utilizing a robust activity and nutrition tracking app. Another simple, effective, and popular self-monitoring technique is journaling. This practice puts the client's thoughts and actions right in front of them to see at any time. Journaling should be coached to be free-flowing and without pause, resembling a stream of consciousness writing. In the case of improving fitness or losing weight, journaling around actions related to these goals should be encouraged. Additionally, the client should journal about their experiences, thoughts, and feelings as they journey toward their success. The type of self-monitoring mechanisms implemented should be up to the client and coincide with their own comfort level. The important part of this process will be the consistency with which the client carries out the practice.
First one, here's the, I actually don't have a role play version of this. It's the other video I'm going to show you today. Okay. I actually didn't need to show that first one. The other one is the one I want to show you. Looking at self-monitoring, right? Like journaling, workout journal, workout log, whatever. All of those things are really, really, really great. So we're going to take a look at like sort of what that looks like, right? And there's been like really positive, this has not only helped with like cognitive stuff, this has helped with like thoughts and feelings, you know, it gets your thoughts out on paper, but it's all, you know, which improves your mood and stuff. This has literally been shown to decrease like physical pain. They've actually used like pain journaling and like, you know, like veterans and stuff who've experienced like injuries, or like athletes who have experienced injuries, or just like people who have like worked, maybe have gotten hurt on the job. They have actually seen, you know, therapists who will then apply the idea of like pain journaling, and it actually has been shown to decrease physical. So it has some pretty, you know, fascinating effects here, right? We know that it's really effective for us when it comes to fitness and health, but it's also really effective just in terms of like, you know, healthy lifestyles and stuff. So that is where self-monitoring really comes in to be really handy. I do actually want to show you, just before I get into it, just because there should be a little sort of break here in the middle, I want to show you guys one more crash course. This is the last crash course video I'm going to show for quite some time. So this is actually very much a take on this. Where the heck is it? It was the next episode. It should be episode 12. There it is. The Bobo beatdown. All right, this is kind of a weird, fun story.
Frustrated kid. It's 1961. You're wandering around Stanford University looking for a sandwich or something when you happen to walk by a particular room in a particular lab and see something a little unnerving. Namely, you find a woman punching an inflatable clown named Bobo in the neck, over and over in its neck. This was the lab of legendary psychologist Albert Bandura, and in 1961, he was studying one of the most important phenomena in psychology. See, while that woman was throttling that big inflatable clown, there was a child watching her, and after about 10 minutes of observing this clown-beating display, the kid was taken to a room full of fun toys, which were soon taken away, and then the frustrated kid was left alone with Bobo, and Bandura watched what happened. And yeah, what happened was kind of scary. Kids who watched the woman beating the clown were much more likely to mimic her aggression, kicking, punching, throwing, even attempting to maul Bobo with a hammer. But other children who saw an adult playing nicely with a doll or just ignoring it didn't respond the same way in their frustration. Bandura's results may seem predictable now, but in those days they challenged the dominant behaviorist views that we talked about last week. The views that learning is solely about conditioning and association, rewards and punishments. Bandura's research focused on how learning can occur through through observing and imitating someone else's behavior. And if that seems obvious to you, you have Bandura to thank for that. His research hastened the evolution of 20th century experimental psychology from pure behaviorism into what we now know as social cognitive learning. While it was closely related to behaviorism, the social cognitive models added profoundly new dimensions to what Skinner and Watson and Pavlov had observed in our feathered and furry friends. In other words, it showed us that just as there is more than one way to beat up a clown, there's more than one way to learn. Last week, we talked about the differences between classical and operant conditioning in associative learning, the kind of learning that comes from connecting different events and stimuli. In classical conditioning, this means associating a stimulus with some kind of involuntary response, the whole dog slobbering at the sound of a bell phenomenon, whereas operant conditioning makes associations between stimulus and a voluntary behavior, like the rat pressing a lever to get delicious snacks or jumping out of a cage to avoid an electric shock. And that's all well and good, but if learning is the process of acquiring and retaining new behavior and information, then Bandura's experiments showed us that conditioning with external rewards, punishment, or other stimuli isn't the only way to do it. It's hard to deny that pretty much all animals are capable of learning certain things by association, but critics of behaviorists like Pavlov, Watson, and Skinner had a problem with their assertions that when it came to learning, it didn't matter much whether you're training rats, pigeons, or people. It's all the same, because lots of research has demonstrated that an animal's capacity for conditioning is actually limited by its biology. Consider this scenario. Say, I get a raging case of food poisoning after eating my head weight in raw oysters with my friend Bernice. I'm probably not going to want to touch oysters again for a long, long time because I associate their smell and taste with the smell and taste that they made when they were coming back out. That's what I'm trying to say. But that doesn't mean that the sight of Bernice or the sound of the sea shanties that they were playing at the restaurant would make me barf, because humans are, by our very nature, more taste-averse than we are sight or sound-averse. On the other hand, sight-oriented animals like birds may be biologically predisposed to avoid tainted food by sight, since that's how they hunt and forage. And presumably they go to restaurants that play better music. Anyway, all this tells us that species can more easily learn associations that help them thrive or survive, and that not all associations are learned equally. It's a lot easier to teach a pigeon to peck an X on the ground to obtain a food reward than it is to get it to flap its wings to get that same reward, because pecking is a natural foraging behavior for a pigeon. In the same way, it would be much harder for the bird to learn to peck that X to avoid a shock rather than to flap its wings to avoid the shock, because flying away from danger is what pigeons naturally do. Learned associations are even more complicated in humans, of course, because what we learn doesn't only influence our behavior, it also shapes our attitudes. Our cognition, that is, our thoughts, perspectives, and expectations, is important for learning, as is our social context, as Bandura figured out. So Pavlov-style conditioning experiments that ignore those social cognitive elements can really run into trouble. For example, someone under treatment for an alcohol addiction may be given booze laced with a nauseating drug. According to the pure classical conditioning model, that person would then equate booze with feeling nasty. But the brain can override this association if it's aware that the added drug and not the alcohol is the thing that's causing the illness. Sometimes we can think our way out of intended associations. And by the same token, a person's social context, like their friends, family traditions, or life stressors, can reinforce something like alcohol consumption more than the nauseating pill could ever punish it. Plus, we also do a lot of latent learning, like without even knowing it. Have you ever been walking around a new city, someone stops you to ask for directions, and you surprise yourself by actually being able to tell that tourist how to get to the park? That's because we're constantly developing cognitive maps or mental representations of our surroundings without explicitly telling ourselves to do it. We've all seen the experiments with rats and mazes. Well, those show us that even rats develop these cognitive maps, figuring out how to get around even if there's no reward at the end. And days later, when they finally do get food at the end of the maze, they quickly demonstrate all that earlier latent learning by scuttling through the maze as fast or faster than rats that had been rewarded all along. So learning isn't just about associating a response with a consequence. There's thinking happening too. And this kind of thinking is also a big part of observational learning, which is basically learning by watching other people or being influenced by them in other ways. Because you don't need direct experience to learn. You can just pick stuff up through modeling. Not like modeling on the catwalk, I just mean observing and imitating specific behaviors. Rats, crows, pigeons, primates, and other animals learn through imitation. Chimps learn how to use sticks to fish ants out of a nest this way. One study found that rhesus macaques were usually slow to make up after a fight, unless they grew up watching more forgiving older macaques, in which case they tended to make up more quickly.
great.
Of course, we humans learn a lot from modeling. I mean, most of our popular culture is based on it. New slang, skinny jeans, foodie trends, pixie cuts. They're all racing around the globe through observation and imitation. So it makes a lot of sense that social observation shapes behavior, especially in children. Which brings us back to Bobo. Again, the fact that we learn by imitating even when we don't mean to seems pretty intuitive. But until Bandura's famous experiment, it hadn't been studied in a scientific way. I mean, these kids started abusing Bobo not just with little toddler punches, but with hostile language, and even using things like toy guns that they'd previously had no interest in. And all because they saw aggressive modeling in action. And since Bandura's time, technology has allowed us to peer even deeper into this dynamic. Neuroimaging in humans, for instance, has shown that when an individual watches someone else, especially someone whom they relate to, receive an award or score a goal or something, their own brain's reward systems light up vicariously. Italian researchers found this out pretty much by accident in the early 1990s. They were studying signals from key regions in a lab monkey's brain that were associated with planning and doing. Their brain monitoring device buzzed softly when the monkey did something like pick up a piece of fruit and eat it. But one hot day, a researcher came back from lunch licking an ice cream cone and suddenly heard the animal's brain monitor buzz. The monkey was watching him, and his brain worked as if he was actually doing the licking. Many scientists suspect that this is the work of a previously unknown type of brain cell called mirror neurons, which fire when a subject both performs an action and when they observe someone else doing it. Mirror neuron research is still relatively new, and we're still figuring them out. But combined with Bandura's earlier work, it's revealing a strong connection between observation, imitation, and learning. So the takeaway here is, models are important. And not just Giselle and Antonio Sabato Jr. You can, if you want, observe and imitate them. I'm just saying that observational social learning starts really early, and parental figures are powerful role models. Positive, supportive, and loving models usually prompt similar behavior in others, just as negative, aggressive modeling can spark antisocial effects. And as we'll talk about later, what we see and feel and learn as children is not easily displaced when we're adults. Literary giant George Bernard Shaw wrote, "Imitation is not just the sincerest form of flattery, it's the sincerest form of learning." And British statesman Lord Chesterfield once said, "We are, in truth, more than half what we are by imitation." Even if these ideas were only half true, they'd still be a powerful lesson on who you choose to spend your time with and how you choose to act. If you learned anything by watching me today, hopefully it involves the limitations of classical and operant conditioning, the basics of cognitive, observational, and social learning, a look at mirror neurons, and how to beat up a Bobo doll. Thanks for watching, especially to all of our subable subscribers who make this whole channel possible. If you'd like to sponsor an episode of Crash Course, get a special decal, or even be animated into an upcoming episode, just go to subable.com. This episode was written by Kathleen Yale, edited by Blake DiBastino, and our consultant is Dr. Ranjit Bhagwat. Our director and editor is Nicholas Jenkins, and the script supervisor is Michael Aranda, who is also our sound designer, and the graphics team is Thought Cafe.
Okay, so that's a little bit on how our thoughts, right, and how we draw these like learned associations. And then those learned associations have a lot to do with sort of how we behave around the world, right? So he drew sort of a learned association with this sort of like violent action, right? A lot of times we will draw like these learned associations with like food or like how we approach things like emotionally, you know, like a conflict and with others and things like that. And so then like, you know, you get into a conflict with someone that stresses you out. And then because you have an association with like when you are stressed, you seek comfort in food, that can bring you to like, you know, you may be eating something that you don't intend to eat, right? So let's take a look at like problem solving here, right? So problem solving is one of the methods that we can use to sort of overcome if we have like a negative emotional response to something that we are maybe associated with, right? If we do something that we are, you know, actively trying to avoid, you know, problem solving is one of our most effective methods here. And so problem solving follows this sort of three-step method that I always like to allude to in the realm of like personal training, because a lot of what personal training is problem solving. But they are sort of breaking it down into five steps, which in my opinion is way too many steps. They're going a little bit more detailed than they really need to here, but looking at the ideas of problem solving, right? Problems are dilemmas that don't have immediate solutions, right? So like, you know, problem solving can be solved by, like, you know, breaking this thing down where it's like, oh, I don't know how to do this. And like, there's no way that I'll ever be able to overcome this like obstacle. Like, some people feel that losing weight, they are just completely helpless at it. And there's no way that, like, you know, it's like they've tried different diets, they've tried different exercise programs, and they've never gotten results. I'll never get results. And it's like, they get this like very overwhelmed feeling, right? So it's a dilemma. And they're like, there's no solution. There's no end in sight. I'm just stuck this way, right? And it's like, respectfully disagree. Let's go ahead and break this down in, you know, ways that it's like, all right, well, let's take a look at like what the problem is. Let's take a look at this dilemma and see if we can analyze and fix this, right? So 5 steps. First one is to generalize and set. And like I said, this is not even really part of problem solving necessarily. This is like a pre-contemplator situation, which again, you're probably not going to run into too many pre-contemplators. First thing you need to do is what we call general orientation. You need to set the problem. Basically, you need to recognize that there is a problem before you can start working on it. Again, this is why I think that like we don't necessarily, this is why I think 5 steps is too many steps. But the first thing, I mean, don't get me wrong, I think it's incredibly important. It's something that you absolutely have to do. You do have to like recognize that it is a problem. You hear about like, if anybody in here knows anybody who's ever been through like Alcoholics Anonymous, the first thing that they teach you is that you have to like admit that alcohol is a problem for you. And what you'll hear people do a lot of times, they're like, oh, well, you know, I only like to do it here. And it's like, look, you need to recognize this is like a destructive behavior in your life before you're ever going to be able to fix it. Let's say you have a client who, you know, struggles with their eating. It's like, look, we need to recognize that like we have like a food addiction problem, or we have like a food problem. This is something that is like taking away from this other aspect of your life. This is the problem. So the first thing you do is you have to admit it, right? You have to admit that there's sort of a problem here. And that's sort of, in my opinion, like a pre-step to the actual problem solving method. But before you can ever actually like move forward, you first have to recognize that it's, you know, it's an issue. Step 2 is the problem definition. So the second thing you need to do is separate relevant information, right? So separating your relevant information from your irrelevant information, where it's like, oh, well, you know, it's only a problem because, you know, I only do it when I'm around friends, or I only do this thing, you know, I only tend to overeat and, you know, take fast food when I do this kind of thing. And it's like, okay, great. Is that information actually relevant? Because like, if it's still holding you back, it doesn't matter where you do it. Like, this is like when I talk about like smokers, for instance, when I'm working with clients who are smokers, I'm like, you know, sometimes it's like, well, you gotta, you know, cut that out. We gotta get rid of smoking. There's no redeeming qualities. Like, it's always bad for you. And like, this is something we definitely want to eliminate. And someone's like, oh, well, I only smoke when I go out to the bar, and I don't go out to the bar that often. And it's like, well, still, like, it is, you know, even if you're doing it occasionally, it's causing damage, right? So like the idea that like you only do it every now and then isn't really relevant to this conversation, you know, like it's, so we're going to separate that irrelevant information. Or like sometimes somebody's like, this is where I'm sure you guys have experienced this when you've like counseled friends or family, or, you know, just talking to people. When you have that person who's just like, oh, well, and they kind of make excuses and they pull things in from their life. And it's like, oh, I've just been really stressed lately. I've been doing this. And it's like, okay, like you're overeating because you've been stressed lately. But like, you know, our job is to like create like healthy habits. We ideally want to separate food from anxiety. We want to separate your eating habits from like your work habits, your stress habits. So like we are trying to separate any irrelevant information. So like how stressed you are shouldn't play a role. It does play a role right now. We want to get it to a place where it doesn't, right? So that's the sort of second step. And so like I said, both of those are actually kind of a little bit different there, right? So that problem definition, we want to make sure that we have a very clear idea of what it is that we're actually working on, and making sure that like other information isn't getting in there and like kind of cluttering everything up. Step 3, we're going to start generating some alternatives. So we're going to come up with a bunch of different solutions. And again, I like to combine steps 3 and 4. together. But the first thing you're going to do is you're going to generate some alternates. You're going to come up with some solutions to the problems. Now, here's the thing. When it comes to generating solutions, guys, throw everything that you can think of at the wall. And we're just going to see what sticks. You know, if it's like, oh, well, you know, like what we don't want to do is like, it's like, oh, well, I want to improve my eating. What I could do is I could get a meal plan. And then immediately you're like, no, I probably can't afford like a meal plan. I don't care. Put it down. Write it on the list. You know, let's get it out there. Don't judge the problem. Don't judge the solutions just yet. Give me every solution you've got, right? And it's like, maybe I could hire a personal chef. That's probably not realistic for most of us, but put it on the list. Because if you just start generating ideas and you start throwing things at the wall and seeing what will stick, eventually it gets the juices flowing and you're like, oh, what if I tried this? 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 And that's one of my favorite steps when it comes to problem solving, is just coming up with a big long list of ways that you can come up with these solutions, right? Step four, you're gonna actually make like a decision. Step four, you're going to choose the best strategy. So once you've sort of thrown everything at the wall, right, everything there is, then you're going to kind of come to and pick like the best version of things, right? You're like, okay, the personal chef thing, probably not realistic for me, but, and meal prepping, like, you know, is something that I could probably commit to. Buying pre-made meal plans is also probably pretty expensive, but I struggle the most with breakfast. So what if I bought a bunch of pre-made breakfasts that are really healthy from like a meal plan service, and then I did like meal prep for lunch and dinner and then had snacks throughout the day? That's something that I could stick to. It's like, great, there we go. Like, we took maybe, you know, we threw out like, we could, meal planning was an option, buying pre-made meals was an option, you know, getting a personal chef was an option. And it's like, this one was very unrealistic. These both kind of aspects of both of them kind of work. So that's where step four kind of comes in. You're going to choose whatever strategy. And like I said, I like to kind of combine these steps when I'm generating alternatives, kind of just come up with a solution right away. And then step five is verification. Try it out. You know, like, let's see if this actually works. Let's see if this has sort of the positive impact that we want it to. So I like a three-step process. I like to kind of boil down problem solving to three steps. Number one, identify the problem, right? Accept that there's a problem exists and get a very clear definition of it. Step two, solve the problem, come up with like whatever solution you think is going to be best. And that is, you know, generating alternatives and sort of decision-making there. And then step three is like, you know, try it out, do it. Friggin' get to work, you know? That's sort of the third step there. Let's say a client walks into the gym and their knees cave in when they squat because they have overactive adductor muscles, right? So step one is being like, you've got overactive adductor muscles. Recognize that a problem exists. Define that problem. Step two, you're going to solve that problem. Be like, well, what you need to do are some adductor stretches. You need to strengthen your medial glute. That's going to pull your legs out this way. And that's going to allow the pulling to happen because we're going to loosen up these muscles, right? So now I've solved the problem by writing a program. Step three, what am I going to do? I'm going to train my client. I'm going to get them to do it. I'm going to verify that this freaking works. So that's, in my opinion, the sort of three-step method that I kind of prefer because it's a little more boiled down. I talk about this constantly with my clients. I'm like, all right, what are we working on? And they're like, here's my goal. And it's like, great. And then I come up with a solution. I'm like, step one, there's your goal. Step two, here's our plan. Step three, let's get to work. You know, love problem solving. One of my favorite freaking things to talk about all freaking day. but I won't. We're going to move on. So another technique related to cognitive behavioral therapy is also looking at stress management. It's a method of focusing on like finding ways to reduce stress, right? It aims at identifying what maybe someone's stressors are. What's a big like stressor that somebody has, and then finding a way to sort of deal with that. So like, one of the ways that we're going to do this, stress inoculation. Okay. And there's lots of stress out there, right? There's like major life-changing events, like maybe moving to a new city, that's seriously stressful. Death of a loved one is extremely stressful. And these are things that will sometimes derail progress, right? Like these major life-changing events can lead to someone feeling stress, like they don't have control over their life. And so then like they fall out of good habits. They stop exercising, they stop showering, they start, you know, doing all these things that kind of happen when you go through like a breakup or whatever. You know, sometimes when you get really stressed, like you'll kind of do these things. Don't eat as healthy as often, you know, maybe seek comfort in like junk food. So those are like major life events, but even like small daily hassles can lead to this as well. You get stuck in traffic, you have bad weather, maybe you just perform poorly at work, or you're late, or you misplace your keys. These things that like stresses out, it's like, oh, you misplaced your keys and you're stressed out. And it's like, God, you're driving to work. And then like, as you're going into work, normally you take the stairs, but you're like, you know, and it's like, maybe you made up for time on the, this is like, maybe you made up for time on the commute and you got to work at exactly the same time, but you're like, oh, I'm stressed out, I was late this morning. And then you take the elevator and it's like, you still had time to take the stairs like you normally do. But like, you started to draw this like association where you're like, nope, stressed, I got to do this. Like, I got to be nice to me. And so I'm going to take it easy today. And it's like, wow, well, now it's going to pull you off your goal. And then all of a sudden, like, you're pulled off your goal, you're not meeting your goals, and then you're stressed out because of that, right? And that's not great, right? And so like, it's funny how like little things can kind of like sort of snowball into these big events. And so that's where sort of understanding our stressors and learning how to deal with stress is a big deal. So when it comes to stress, one of the best tools that we've got to sort of deal with this is what we call stress inoculation. And it's basically how you build sort of psychological antibodies to stress, right? So like we think about like what a vaccine is, right? It's so that we have antibodies to sort of fight off like a virus. Well, stress inoculation is sort of the vaccine version of dealing with stress, right? So like trying to prevent like problematic emotions due to a stressor, right? So preventing, you know, like if you have like a negative attachment with like a specific like situation, or if you have a specific sort of negative attachment to sort of an event or something like that, learning how to sort of build a positive association with that thing, or at least like a neutral one, is going to have like a really positive effect here. So finding healthy ways to deal with your stress is what we're looking for. So one of the ways that we're going to do this is cognitive restructuring. And this is the video I want to show you guys. Like I said, not the world's greatest actor here, but this is a really good actor. Is it the guy? No, it's not this one. It's the other, the fourth one. Good Lord, that would have been twice in a row. This is cognitive restructuring. Jesus. All right, here we go.
Oftentimes, people in helping professions will hear their clients make negative statements about themselves and their abilities to make and maintain the healthy lifestyle choices that they need to meet their wellness goals. Constant negative thoughts, or automatic problematic thoughts, can be pervasive and destructive to a client's ability to move past setbacks or prevent them from making progress on their goals altogether. Being able to identify these types of thoughts and having strategies for turning them into less negative or even positive thoughts is an important skill when working on challenging goals. You can work with your clients to identify some of those thoughts and help the client determine what might be the best strategy to combat that negativity.
Hey man, great to see you again. How's everything been going?
I've been better.
How's that? I mean, everything okay?
I'm unhappy with the lack of progress I've had. You know, I'm starting to lose motivation and I'm considering giving up.
I mean, as you know, we've been monitoring your weight loss over the past few months, every week. And so far you've been on track with your weight loss up until last week.
I know, but it's last week that I'm concerned about. You know, it was terrible. I should have lost weight. I mean, I worked out and I followed the meal plan to the T. I was just really frustrating.
Wow. I see this has gotten to you. I want to emphasize that this happens, okay? I mean, it is normal to have a week where you don't lose as much as you have previously, all right? And I'm curious, how do you usually respond to a situation where you feel you've had a setback?
Pretty much like this failure. You know, I get down on myself and I, you know, decide that, you know, I'm not successful and I want to quit.
First off, this is not a failure. It might be considered a small setback, but it's definitely not a failure. You know, I'm concerned about how you view this. I want to work with you, help you reframe the situation and what you see as a major setback into, you know, a less negative statement.
What do you mean?
Well, for example, you just said that last week was terrible and you should have lost weight.
Right.
All right, so why don't we turn this thing around into something more like, I feel as though I did everything I should have to lose weight last week. You know, I also realize that my overall goal is weight loss. You know, 1 week should not be taken too seriously. My actions, they were on point. Now, I have a sheet of paper here, list of words, absolute and extreme words not to use, to avoid. Words like awful, all, every, horrible, terrible, must have, need, you know, and so on. The list, it's not comprehensive, but it will help you begin to recognize these types of words as you practice restructuring your negative thoughts and statements. So I think this is important for you to track your negative thoughts and statements. And every time you have one, you should, you know, write down that negative thought, write down the time of day, you know, write down the emotion you were feeling, and of course what the original negative thought or statement was.
Right.
Right? And of course I want you to write down what the turnaround thought should be. So tomorrow, I don't want you to use any of these words. It's not going to be easy, it'll be tough. But at least it'll help you begin to recognize how often you use these negative words and negative statements. How about let's practice on this one? I want you to share with me a recent negative thought or statement you had about one of your set goals.
Well, I really hate it when my friends offer me fatty foods and you know, they put me in a horrible bind when they do that.
Yeah, I understand. Can you tell me what day you had this thought?
It was earlier today.
Wow.
Lunchtime.
Today. How about the emotion you were feeling at the time?
I was definitely annoyed.
Okay, well, that's good. This is a good example. Let's turn this around. How can you make this more of a less negative statement?
Well, I know my friends don't know about my nutrition program, so if I shared with them about it, they'd probably be more supportive. And I know they're not trying to cause harm, and they're actually trying to be nice to me. You know, the nutrition program is a challenge, but it's not horrible.
It is. You know what? Great job. Good job, bud.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, of course.
As you can see, constant negative thoughts can have a negative impact on a client's motivation. However, these negative thoughts can be turned around and eventually altogether avoided with practice. It's important to note that being able to both identify and turn around negative thoughts is a learned skill that can take a client a while to master. So practice and encouragement will be needed.
Okay. So that's a little bit of like what we call cognitive restructuring. That's one of the ways that we can sort of inoculate ourselves to stress. You can see like what we were trying to do in that Oscar award-winning presentation is that we're trying to teach someone how to say, like, when someone has like an instant negative thought, right? They have a negative association, a negative emotion, stress to, like an initial, like whatever stressor it happens to be, they have this like instant, very negative thing. Like he gets really frustrated when he doesn't meet his goals, right? When he like feels like he's not making the progress he's making, he has this immediate sort of shutdown thing. And then his immediate reaction is to quit. And it's like, I'm not good enough. I can't do this. His immediate reaction is to like give up, right? Because that's sort of the path of least resistance here, but that's not healthy, right? It's not a very, very, very like effective method. You know, so what the trainer was trying to do is he's trying to like help him sort of restructure his life. Like, look, like we can accept that, like, yes, this was not a great week for maybe us working towards our goal, but let's use this as like a learning opportunity, right? Like, let's take this as an opportunity to be like, yeah, like I definitely did struggle. And we know that like we are going to meet our goal in the end. So what do we have to do to like make that happen faster? What do we have to do to make that a reality? How do we make up for this like tough week? It's like, what do we have to look at to solve this problem rather than just accept that it's, you know, this frustrating thing that we cannot overcome? So this is one of the things that like when you're working with this, guys, I love to tell my clients this all the time. There's a difference between lapsing and relapsing. Like you're going to have a bad week. Everybody's going to hit a plateau because your body's designed to make you plateau. If you're on like a weight loss routine, you're on a muscle gaining routine, if you're on a increase your athleticism routine, your body is designed to maintain homeostasis. It's not designed to lose weight. It's not really designed to gain weight either. It's designed to try to stay exactly the same, but it's going to err on the caution. It's going to err on the side of like gaining weight. And so that's why losing weight and changing your body composition is so freaking difficult. It's challenging because your body is designed to maintain itself, right? And so there's a difference between lapsing and relapsing. A lapse is like a temporary misstep. There's going to be a bad day, bad week, whatever, right? And it's okay to like recognize that's like, oh man, this was a crap week. That sucks. You know, like I had a terrible week at Ultimate last week. I just got my butt kicked up and down the field. And it was just, I don't know what it was. I was playing a little poorly. Other people were playing really well, you know, and it was hot and I just wasn't hydrated. There was a whole bunch of things that were going on. And if I were to look at that and go like, well, I guess I'm just terrible at Ultimate Frisbee and I should never play ever again, right? That would be an example of me like relapsing, like out of a healthy habit, like back into an old, maybe problematic behavior of just staying indoors all day and, you know, being unphysically active, right? That's an example of like a relapse. And that's what we're trying to avoid. We are trying to avoid relapse like the plague, but we can accept that lapses are going to happen. Like this is just something that is going to occur. All of us are going to hit a plateau. All of us are going to fall off the wagon temporarily. This will, birds fly, fish swim, the grass is green and the sky is blue. You will lapse at some point. It's just going to happen. But when it happens, recognizing it and then like making sure that it doesn't turn into a relapse is going to be really key. And that's what we're here to help our clients with. Your client, you know, the world's best client is going to wake up late and miss their training session. And they're still the world's best client. But then they're going to be like, you know, maybe they have like a psychological spiral where they're just like, I feel like I'm not gonna be able to do this. And it's like, nope, we got to stop those negative thoughts and we got to turn them around and be much more positive. And that is where, you know, we got sort of five steps again, good Lord, to sort of like preventing a lapse from becoming a relapse. First thing is just to accept that it happened. It's like, look, we can both recognize that, yes, this was a temporary misstep. This was not in the direction of our goal, but that's okay because we still got plenty of time to reach our goal. We still got plenty of ways that we're going to sort of overcome this. We can sort of make up for it. So first thing, accept it. Now let's go back and see like how this actually happened. What was it that sort of like knocked us off course? So he hit the replay button, right? Now let's see what we could have done differently. So we hit the replay button, but it's sort of an imagination thing. Do a little bit of visualization where it's like, all right, I know that like I was I'm actively trying to avoid fast food, but I had a really stressful day at work. And on my way home, I, you know, decided to stop by Carl's Jr. This is actually a real life example that I have with a client. And that was the thing. Every time they got like stressed, they would stop by fast food. And so I was like, okay, well, let's sort of replay it with like the correct action. What could you have done instead when it comes to like, you know, stopping at that freaking Carl's Jr.? Because there was one like somewhat near his house. It was near his work. That's what it was. It was like right as he would leave work, he would take like a right and it would be on the right, like, and he could just roll right into the parking lot. That's what it was. Because our solution was, it's like, okay, how do we replay this with the correct action? And it's like, what are some things? And we generated alternatives. And what we came up with was like, all right, well, from now on, it's going to be a little bit less convenient, but you're going to take a left outside of work and you're going to go get on the 101 instead of the, or yeah, you're going to, oh yeah, that's what it was. You're going to take a left and then go up a block, and then that's gonna how you're gonna get on your exit, because there's no fast food in that direction. And that was the thing that kind of helped it, you know. And so like then we're just gonna self-monitor regularly, where it's like, okay, the next time you have like a stressful day, you know, we're gonna recognize that like that what's the correct action, and we're gonna kind of keep track of it and sort of self-monitor that. And then the next thing is just to move on and be like, look, don't dwell on it. You're self-monitoring, you're playing the correct action, you're doing the right play. You could dwell on it forever and that's only going to lead to frustrations, or you could accept it and move on, you know? And that's really what we're trying to do, when it comes to kind of processing these things. Right. But the big one that I have with my client, like I said, I was really proud of that really clever solution. It was like, what if we took a different route on the way out? You know? And it's like, 'cause stressful days are something that we can't avoid. That's going to happen. You know, we're going to all have bad days, you know, you're going to have a day where you wake up way too late and you're just like, I'm tired. I don't want to go to the gym. You stayed up too late. Thomas, you're going to have a day where, you know, family's in town visiting and you're going to be too swamped and they're going to be like, no, come hang out with us. And you're like, no, I got to go to the gym. You know, these are going to happen. These are going to be things that happen, right? And it's so funny because I want to use exercise examples whenever I'm talking about this stuff, but it's like, I know both of you guys are both like very dedicated to exercising and eating healthy and stuff. But it's like your clients, these are sort of the examples that you're going to kind of run into. Like, again, like I actually don't really have a problem when it comes to like, you know, remembering to exercise or remembering to eat healthy. Those are both things that I do pretty naturally, but like, you know, it took me a little while to get used to. I can't tell you, Thomas, to use you as an example. You make your bed every day. It seems very natural for you. Me, when I first started quarantine and had to like do these Zoom calls, it was so many times like I'd sit down, I'd get my camera ready, I'd look in the camera and be like, crap, my bed. And I had already sent out the morning text and people were like joining in on the calls. And I was like, ah, and I'd like run back there and like make it really fast. You know, and it's like, that's sort of like a new habit that was like not natural for me to sort of make, right? And it's like, I, you know, on days I could get really down on myself and be like, oh man, you're so bad at stuff, you know? Or it could just be like, look, like this is something that happened. And like, what I needed to do was like, just be a little bit more structured about it. Think a little bit more, be a little more aware before my call starts. And then all of a sudden, like, you know, I wouldn't have had this like stressful second. And that's, you know, I know it's small potatoes, but everybody's going to be a little bit different. You know, everybody's going to have sort of their different things. So there's a couple different ways that we're going to sort of look at cognitive behavioral therapy, right? A lot of times, like these are very much associated with the words that we choose to use. You know, there's a lot of extreme words. I tend to be a pretty extreme person when I'm describing things, like certain words that I tend to use, or I sometimes tend to use like a lot of like very absolute words. So like extreme words are things like all or awful or horrible or terrible or totally. Absolute words are things like, you know, have to or need this or that. And it's like, oh, I'm just terrible at, you know, losing weight. I'm horrible at like sticking to a diet. I'm awful about waking up on time. You know, it's like, hey, these are all like really extreme things to say. You know, let's see if we can maybe restructure that. Let's see if we can turn that around and say something a little bit more, you know, a little bit more effective or a little bit more, I'm forgetting the word that I want to say. Constructive, you know, helpful, right? Well, let's use some helpful words instead. So it's like, maybe we say something where it's like, you know, my client who would go to Carl's Jr., he's like, I just suck. He's like, I'm just so bad at sticking to a diet. And it's like, well, it's like, you have the, you know, you have the problem of like, you know, pulling into this thing because it's sort of a natural thing. You know, it happens to be very convenient for you. And like, you do need food, right? Like when it's time to go, you know, it's time for dinner. Like you do need this thing. It's like, you know, it's not that you're, you know, terrible or weak-willed or anything like that. That's a crazy sentence. What it is just you happen to have like a lifestyle that it is very convenient for you to do this thing that unfortunately is bad for you. And it's like, it's a bummer that it's not as convenient for you to do something that's healthy for you. And so that's a way of like kind of restructuring it, right? Like we're all dealt a bad hand every now and then, you know? We can either like live with that bad hand or look to kind of, you know, trade that card in and see if, you know, we can get a, you know, it's like playing stud poker, you know? It's like, I'm going to take two, you know? we can try to trade it in and hope for something a little bit better. And that's where what we call rational emotive therapy comes in. So rational emotive therapy is a form of behavior, of cognitive behavioral therapy that works to sort of decrease the irrationality of what we call automatic problem thoughts. Okay. So it changes how we express ourselves in the hopes that like, if we use a different language, we will create like much more positive changes, right? This is why like, you know, I never let my clients get away with this. There's like a weird thing where it's like, I'm sure Thomas, I'm sure Bay, I'm sure you guys have said this. I'm sure I've said this when you're like working out really hard and you're like, oh God, I'm dying, right? Like I'm dying. That's the most extreme thing somebody could say, right? When they're working out, they're like, I'm dying. But whenever I hear someone say that, I always go, no, you're living. You're doing quite opposite, quite the opposite. I love to bring that up. And I love to like immediately turn someone's words around on them. I don't know. It's one of my favorite ones that I've used for years. I feel like it comes up all the time. I'm dying. Nope, you're living. You are quite literally living. And it's just a way of like sort of turning these what we call automatic problem thoughts around, right? So like everybody's going to have like a lot of versions of this. The most common versions of automatic problem thoughts. And automatic problem thoughts, I got to give the definition here. They're pervasive problematic thoughts. They're like, I'm terrible at this. I suck. I'm the worst. You know, like these automatic sort of ways of thinking, right? So what we want to do is we want to work with our clients to sort of generate alternative versions of those thoughts, right? Because what a lot of people are going to have are what are called schemas, okay? So schemas are these pervasive irrational thoughts, these really negative thoughts that somebody has that they are sort of stuck with. There's a couple different versions of schemas out there. But like there are things like catastrophizing, for instance, or overgeneralization. Overgeneralization is like, I'm just the worst. I'm just terrible. I'm bad stuff in general. It's like, look, I'm bad at drawing. That doesn't mean that I'm bad at exercise. And it has nothing to do with like me being a bad driver and has nothing to do with me being bad about going to bed on time. Like, yes, there are things that I'm good at and there's things that I'm bad at. Like, and that's okay. But like overgeneralizing and like taking one thing that you are maybe like struggling with and then applying it to the rest of your life is a crazy thing to do. And that is definitely something we're trying to help our clients avoid. They're like, well, I'm just always bad at exercise. And it's like, really? Or are you just bad at like, you know, going to a group, are you bad at going to a group exercise class? Like, what do you mean you're bad at exercise? And it's like, oh, I can never carve out the time. Oh, so what you mean to say is that you're busy? Everyone's busy. That doesn't mean that you're bad at exercise. And it's like, no, I'm bad at going to the gym. And it's like, okay, well, what are you good at? And it's like, well, I'm good at making time for, you know, X, Y, and Z. And it's like, great. How do we find a way to maybe steal some of that time away for this other healthy activity? You know, that's overgeneralization. I'm just bad at stuff, right? That's overgeneralization. Catastrophizing is another one. Catastrophizing is a classic schema that you're going to run into. Guys, you are going to see catastrophizers. Oh my God. So catastrophizing is like, you know, your client comes in and they're in a really bad mood and you're like, hey, what's the deal? And it's like, oh, I went out with friends last night and I overate and I feel really bad about it. I checked the scale this morning and I was up, you know, a half a pound, even though like I've been really good lately. And it's like, now I, you know, I'm up a half a pound and it's like, I know it's just going to keep gaining and, you know, I'm going to keep overeating and I'm just never going to reach my goals. And I'm not going to look good in that wedding dress that I'm trying to fit into. And then like my wedding, I'm going to have these pictures. I'm going to look terrible. And it's like, whoa. You got all that from like going to dinner with your friends last night? That's catastrophizing, right? It's literally turning mountains out, you know, creating mountains out of molehills. if you guys have ever heard that phrase, my parents used to say that phrase all the time. I can sometimes be like a little bit of a catastrophizer sometimes where it's like, oh, you know, like that's what I think why I get so stressed when I'm stuck in a car or stuck in traffic. I get really stressed out and I feel like I'm going to be late. Even if like the GPS says I'm still going to be on time, I get really stressed just not moving and being stuck in traffic. And so then I'll be like, oh, I'm going to be late and then I'm going to get fired and I'm going to be homeless and then I'm not going to be able to, you know, meet my wife and then my family's going to leave me. You know, it's like, what? You know, all that from being stuck in traffic, that's catastrophizing. I'm exaggerating a little bit, but that's definitely a thing. So those are what schemas are. They're these sort of like pervasive negative thoughts that sometimes people will have. So we got to break them up. We got to destroy these schemas, right? So how we're going to do that, right? The way that we sort of see the sort of schema process be creative, right, is this thoughts and behaviors that are maintained at aiming previously developed schemas, right? So like basically people are going to pick and choose information and they're going to have a little bit of what is called confirmation bias, where it's like, yeah, see, like every time I go out with friends, I gain weight the next morning. And it's like, oh, okay, well, yeah, it could also be that like, you know, maybe you're retaining a little bit of water because yes, you went out with friends, but like, you know, you were careful with your, you know, tracking your calories, you did this, you did that. Maybe it's not so much that like going out is what's causing this. Maybe it's just that like it's a little bit of water retention. So why don't we see if you fall back into like your normal weight like tomorrow, you know? And so that's basically how we're trying to turn those problematic thoughts around. We saw that in the video, right? The guy had all these really negative thoughts and his trainer was trying to help him sort of overcome that. So how do we apply this to the stages of change, right? We're trying to match our utilizations if you have a pre-contemplator or a contemplator, right? Well, this is where, rather than looking at the stages of change, NASM is gonna have you guys use the SWIM model here. Remember, the SWIM model is looking at the cognition side of things. We're gonna analyze our thoughts. You got a client that's in the pre-contemplation stage, it's not going to be effective for you to try to apply turning someone's thoughts around. Instead, just try to get them to recognize that they have pervasive negative thoughts. So learning how to, pre-contemplation is all about the education side of things, right? And so here we're trying to be like, look, we're trying to educate our clients. Like, look, you just need to recognize that this is a problem. That's gonna help somebody move from pre-contemplation to contemplation. Contemplation is like, all right, let's accurately define that problem. That's one of the ways we can get them, right? It's like, we've got this is a problem. Overeating is a problem. It's bad for people, right? It causes obesity, heart disease, all kinds of problems, right? So there's recognizing the problem exists. Now, let's accurately define the problem. When I say overeating, do you think that I mean overeating vegetables? No, I mean overeating like junk food and stuff, right? And when I say junk food, what I mean are foods that are very high in energy, but maybe very low in nutrients, right? So that is accurately defining the problem. Then we got preparation. Preparation is like choosing, like, if you got a client who's actually maybe preparing to make a change within the next 30 days, let's maybe like talk about like how to combat some of those negative thoughts, right? It's like, look, Thomas, in the next 30 days, you're going to start a brand new diet and exercise routine. And guess what? There's going to be a moment in there where you are going to hate me for the way that your legs feel after this workout. It's going to happen. And you're going to want to give up and you're going to want to quit. What are we going to say to ourselves to make sure that like we recognize that like, look, we knew this was going to happen. How do we recognize that we're going to move forward and we're still going to have our success? So this is like a little bit of what I like to call managing expectations, kind of lay it out ahead of time. Right. If you get your client in the action stage, yeah, same thing. We're going to kind of just have like a more extreme version of what we just did. Right. We're verifying things. It's like, hey, maybe recognize that like we've actually reached our goal a little bit. That's the verification. Like, let's see what's working. Let's see what's not working. It's like, hey, we were going to try this. Guess what? It didn't work. Bummer. Let's go back, try something new. I got a client right now and I can't figure out what's going on with her hip, but she's got a little bit of arthritis in her hip. And I've tried this hip stretch, I've tried that hip stretch, and I only get to meet with her once a week. And so the last 2 weeks is where we've been dealing with this problem. And the first thing I tried was like a kneeling hip flexor stretch, because I thought maybe it was like a little bit of hip flexor problem. And I was like, give that a shot and tell me if your hip feels better. So far it didn't work. So she came back this week and I was like, all right, we're gonna try a kneeling hip flexor stretch with a lateral band distraction. Which is this version of a kneeling hip flexor stretch. Not that. Actually, yeah, no, that one. So you can see how the band is going off to the side. Buttons. See how it goes this way? So that's going to pull her femur this way. And she's going to report back to me on Monday and see if like this was the effective one. If that doesn't work, we're going to try a posterior band distraction. We're going to go back this way. We're going to try all these different angles until, we figure out how to fix her hip impingement, because everybody's going to be a little bit different. I'm not quite sure what it is yet. So if I've got a client who's in the action stage, try some things out, throw some stuff at the wall, see what sticks. And then clients in the maintenance stage, again, this is like, you're just going to get them to the next level. You're going to focus on something new. Right. We're going to come up with some coping strategies, develop some resilience, maybe recognize one of my favorite ways to keep somebody in maintenance is to look back on where they used to be and give themselves sort of a mental pat on the back. Love that version of things. So that is basically everything, right? That is cognitive behavioral therapy. So it's similar to behavior therapy. We look at our cues, we look at our behaviors and then our consequences. In this version, we're sort of looking at our cues, looking at our emotions and our consequences. So how do we interrupt those emotions? What kind of wrench can we throw in the gears to sort of get us on the right track of things, Thomas, Bay, you guys got any questions today? How you guys feeling?
I'm feeling good.
Yeah. How are your thoughts and emotions?
Fabulous.
Love it. All right, well, let me kill the recording here.